Welcome to the Blackpool, New York podcast, which is recorded by Newsstand Studio at Rockefeller Center in the heart of Manhattan and is distributed by the Swell Season Surf Radio Network. This is episode number 5 with my good friend, Daniel Rocker. Daniel is a psychotherapist in private practice in New York City, working with individuals, couples, and groups. Dan graduated with a BA from Wesleyan University and an MSW from New York University's Silver School of Social Work. He is a graduate of Ackerman's Clinical Externship Program. Prior to his career as a therapist, Dan worked as a trader at Jefferies and Company and the head of trading for investment firms Rocker Partners and Zimmer Partners. Dan has been an active volunteer in the Doula to Accompany and Comfort Program, providing visits to palliative care patients since 2004. He is the vice president and co-director of the clinical arm of the International Paruresis Association, an organization that provides advocacy and treatment for individuals who suffer with the social anxiety disorder of shy bladder. Paruresis. I had no idea what paruresis even was or how to spell it until Daniel Rocker told me that that's what he was doing. Dan, how are you?
I'm doing very well, Greg. Thanks for inviting me in today.
I'm so curious to hear all about paruresis.
We're diving straight below the belt.
That's we're gonna going to go right below the belt. But I'm just thank you so much for coming, first of all.
Pleasure is all
and
mine.
Thank you to Mr. Joe Hazan for making it sound so good, who helps us here mix the podcasts up on the board. The man is a wizard behind the controls. God, let's just get right into it. Can you tell us what paruresis is, please? Because I'm fascinated.
Sure. I think the simplest definition I could give for paruresis is that paruresis is an inhibition to initiating a stream of urine when you are not in a circumstance in which you feel like you are fully in control. And in most cases, that would be like, say, in your home environment, in your home bathroom. So a lot of people with paruresis have a great deal of difficulty using public restrooms. They have difficulty using restrooms on airplanes. They have difficulty using restrooms basically anywhere that's outside of the home. And it's very clearly established at the outset of the treatment, because I want all of my clients to see a urologist to make sure that there's nothing physical going on. It's clear that it is a mental rather than a physiological problem.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
Is this something that stems from anxiety?
Oh, definitely. It is, formally, it is characterized as a diagnostic feature of social phobia or social anxiety disorder. You can find it listed by name in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. It's under F40.10 or 300.23. That's on page 203 for any of our listeners who want to go look it up and get some substantiation in an official manual like, oh, this is what it's called. This is what I've got. And what it is, as I said, it's a diagnostic feature of social phobia insofar as the real fear has nothing to do with urinating. It's actually a fear of being judged by other people as being inadequate.
Is this something that usually comes from a childhood trauma or something that happens at an early age where this develops?
So I would say that in the minority of cases that people bring to me, and I've worked with several hundred cases already, I'm the president of the International Paruresis Association, and it's about 70% of my practice here in New York City is working with people with paruresis. I would say that it's only in the minority of cases is there an identifiable significant childhood trauma. In most cases, when I hear about childhood trauma, it's bullying, you know, mm-hmm. people, you know, elbowing into the stall while someone's trying to use the stall, or making comments about, you know, someone's appendage while they're standing at the urinal, or pointing out that they haven't started yet or what's the matter with them. And it, you know, the people.
So just the thought of like going to one of those urinals where there's no partitions, where it's just a giant trough.
A trough.
Has got to be just terrifying.
Oh, so for my population, it's basically a no-go.
It's absolutely no-go.
I mean, it might be. I've been working on myself for 22 years, so I could probably perform if I was highly urgent. It's not something I'd be looking forward to do.
Okay, let's back
up. But in the absence, you know, I would say that most of my clients, if there's not a divider between the urinals, are going to have difficulties. Most urinals have dividers between them.
Now, I know most of the listeners here are going to be somewhat curious.
Yes.
Does this relate to defecation as well, or is it only urination?
So the word for it
is
for defecation...
Is there shy pooper syndrome also? Yeah.
Yes. It is. It's called parcopresis. I do not treat parcopresis. Parcopresis is much more difficult to treat. With paruresis, which I do treat, if I give someone a liter and a half of water and an hour, chances are they're going to be hopping foot to foot. They're going to have a high degree of urinary urgency, and we're then going to be able to go and test that urgency by doing graduated exposure in public restrooms. I could give you some fried chicken and some donuts, and God knows when that would want to come
and
out.
And a double espresso.
Right, right. I could give you a double espresso. I mean, unless I was willing to go to your apartment first thing in the morning.
Fire in the
right,
hole.
Right, exactly. So I
Danny,
wouldn't,
I need
it would
you.
Be, it would be much harder for me to structure exposures, but it's very easy to structure exposures around urination.
So some of your patients
yes.
are terrified of urinating in public. However, not like pooping in public is something that's totally fine.
Yes, and just to clarify, it's not that they're terrified at all of urinating in public. Actually, all of us who have paruresis are ecstatic when we're urinating in public. What we're concerned with is not being able to urinate in public. So it literally manifests itself, not as a choice, like I'm not going to urinate because I'm anxious. It's you're just standing there and you're locked up. I'm using air quotes here. It's you feel a high degree of urgency. You are in the appropriate place. You are facing a urinal. You have time, no one's telling you you have to leave, and yet your body won't let you go.
That's fascinating.
And that's because of sympathetic nervous system activation. Your body's basically in fight, flight, freeze mode. And when it's paruresis, it's freeze. It's not, my guys aren't turning around and running out of bathrooms punching people at the adjoining urinals. They are just frozen up.
All right, so let's take a... That was a hell of an intro right there.
I can actually answer, to answer the question.
Just pull the pin on the grenade.
To answer the question very specifically, most of my clients who have paruresis, no, they have no difficulty. That's one of the things that's so mystifying about the disorder to those of us who have it. I could take a dump in the waste paper basket sitting next to your desk. I don't care. It's not a matter of being of politesse or being delicate. I just, when I am at my paruretic moments, I'm just locked up. Mm. It's like, are you familiar with selective mutism?
I'm not.
Okay, selective mutism is a condition where kids speak comfortably at home. They might be a chatterbox, but then you hear in school, the kid's completely silent.
Yeah, they get terrified.
And it's mutism, mm-hmm. but it's selective. It's environmentally selected. And that's, paruresis is like selective mutism, of the urinary function rather than of the speech function.
All right, so let's back way, way up here.
Okay.
Back way up. Where are you from?
Well, I spent the first 6 weeks of my life in Boston, Massachusetts. I was born during the week of finals when my dad was in business school, but I spent the rest of my childhood in Short Hills, New Jersey.
Gotcha.
Where
gotcha.
I went to high school with you.
This is true. A couple years ahead of me.
Yeah,
but
yeah, yeah.
Still.
I'm jumping around. I'm jumping around
in
the timeline.
We have very, very similar reference sets.
Yes.
And then when you graduated from high school, you went to school where? Wellesley?
Oh, Wesleyan, yes.
Wesleyan.
Yeah, went to Wesleyan University.
What did you study there?
I was a double major in English and in psychology.
That's funny that with the English, I was an English major too. And I remember after I had graduated college, I went over to your apartment and you were living downtown somewhere. And I was telling you that I was like studying some like literary theory and I'd read a bunch of Foucault recently. And you're like, oh, come here, come over to the window. And we looked out the window, and I was like, I don't see anything. And you're like, no, it's the panopticon there. It's Foucault's Foucault.
It was absolutely, by virtue of living in having a courtyard view, it was a wonderful apartment. I had no view of the exterior, but I could look into the windows of, you know, all of my neighbors, yeah. And they could all look into my room, into my apartment as well.
That's who we're talking to here, the guy who's like using the Foucault analogy with the English major literary.
If you have to learn criticism about Foucault, you have to be able to drop Foucault.
Yes. Yes, this is true. This is true. So from there, you went and started working in finance.
Yes.
Okay, so talk a little bit about
that. Just a couple of blocks away. I didn't really know what I wanted to do when I graduated college. Mm-hmm. I was a kind of a dissolute student and just wandered around and definitely wasn't an accomplished enough student to even contemplate a PhD in English or psychology. And I really wanted to get out into the workforce. I had some family connections into finance. I had been working over summers in finance since I was 14 years old. And so I went to work just two blocks north of here at Jefferies and Company, which is at 52nd and 5th. And I was what they call a rocket at the time. Actually, mm-hmm. that would be the closest experience to this, is I was kind of like the equivalent of the disc jockey for the trading the trading floor, announcing our merchandise. You know, when people came in, they wanted to sell some IBM, they wanted to buy some General Motors. You know, I would have to, you know, all right, let's get around Boston, let's hit account 32, we're a seller of IBM, you know, let's get around Boston, account 39, Dallas, let's talk to account 52, and, you know, just try to pitch the merchandise.
And that's when it was all on phones, and you had
that's when it was actually, we literally had these like CB operator mics. It was really pretty cool. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. It was fun. Yeah. And of course, all the trading was done on the phones and on the screens. And so I spent 10 months up here. Then I got transferred down to Jefferies Dallas, where I spent a couple of years down there before coming back up here. And I went to work. At that point, my father asked me to come run his trading desk at Rocker Partners. That would have been 1994. I was 25 years old. I can't believe they let kids do stuff like that. But that's what I did for a couple of years. And it was a really good time to get into the trading game. I actually timed my entry and my exit very well without any knowledge.
Well, he knew you would never get up to take a leak. You know, you'd be stuck on the desk the whole time.
You know, I people ask me how I managed with it on Wall Street. I frankly, I don't remember that much. I know it was an issue. I just I negotiated around it.
Right.
Yeah. I guess I was white knuckling it a lot. I wasn't treating myself. I didn't know the word myself either. I didn't know what I had. I thought I was the only person in the world who had the body of a 25-year-old, but the prostate of a 75-year-old. I really didn't understand what was happening to me at all. I actually thought there was something physically wrong with me.
Psychosomatic.
Yes,
completely psychosomatic.
Yes.
All right.
I'll tell you, the one question rule in that I ask people as they say, hey, does this ever happen to you when you're at home and you're alone and you're under no time pressure? And if the answer is yes, then I say, well, you better go see a urologist. But if the answer is no, then I suspect it's paruresis, because we don't swap our parts out when we go to different environments. You know, I've got the same bladder here as at the Yankee game and at my apartment and in Penn Station, and it should work the same way in all those environments, unless my brain is interfering in some way and saying, it doesn't feel safe, doesn't feel, you know, let's be a little more hypervigilant here.
Something like an interesting chapter of your life that I don't really know much about and I want to hear more is you working with palliative care patients.
Ah.
Because you left Wall Street, you've been
15 years ago.
15 years ago.
Yes.
So you were, the trading just didn't call to you anymore.
Yes.
And you went back and got a master's in social work, right?
Yes.
And then started working with palliative care patients.
Well, actually, the order there is, I'll put one asterisk in, and the palliative care work began years before I left Wall Street. It was in the aftermath of 9/11. Mm-hmm. You know, I think a lot of us were having these kind of these feelings of like, what's it all about, Alfie? You know, I'm not guaranteed 70 and a gold watch. You know, a dozen of my buddies just kind of got blown up for showing up at work one day.
Your office was pretty close to the towers.
A few hundred yards away. You recall that we had our kids down at daycare at Trinity there.
Yeah.
So that was about 250 yards from the towers. And my office was maybe, I don't know, 250 yards in the other direction on the, you know, I was at 45 Broadway. So right down where the bull is.
Yep.
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 And so in the aftermath of that terrible after 9/11, I remember kind of casting around and thinking, you know what, if I'm not doing what I want to do with my life, I really should address that now.
How old were you then?
I was 32.
All right, so 32 years old, you actually have the balls to say, I'm not happy doing what I'm doing, and I need to just look for something more.
It was like a call to meaning.
Yeah.
You know, it was, I actually didn't dislike my job. I did like my job a great deal, and I liked the people with whom I worked. It's just that,
yeah, you worked with some amazing individuals. Yeah, some of the most entertaining, smart, like highly, highly intelligent and just creative people.
Yeah, that place, each of those environments was special. And it was like, you know, working with Stu was one of the best times of my life for 10 years. Stu was a high school friend of ours, and he's the Zimmer and Zimmer partners. It's just that I realized that I felt like my intelligence was declining, that I was really just trading the same 60 stocks, you know, day in, day out. And I knew a great deal about the way those stocks acted, but I didn't really know much about anything else in this world. Mm-hmm. I was then too tired and stressed and burned by the time I got home at the end of the day to really move the ball forward towards my own education. I couldn't really autodidact. I was just fried.
Did you have kids at this time?
Oh, sure. Yeah. Grace was 6 months old when the towers came down.
Yep.
And Ruth was born in 2004.
Yep.
And so this was around 2004, around the time that Ruth was born, is when I started. I saw an article in the New York Times. It was the cover Below the Fold.
Did you feel like there were, a lot of the, people that sort of make a career change or change in just the direction of their life and the trajectory that they're living in, they feel called to something. And a lot of the, Ram Dass went to India,
yes.
Met Neem Karoli Baba,
yes.
Studied with Neem, and his whole Neem's philosophy was serve the people,
mm-hmm.
Feed the people. That was it. Mm-hmm. Nothing else. Yep. Serve the people, feed the people. They're like, oh, you're an enlightened saint, and serve the people, feed the people, serve the people. That's all the guy preached. You know, that's it. Just
right.
Be of service. Was there something that after 9/11 that happened where there was a cataclysm, cataclysm or a cataclysmic moment where you were just like, I need to be of service.
Yes. So it was when I found this article on the cover of the New York Times, Below the Fold. The author's name, I believe, was N.R. Kleinfield or Kleinfeld. It was it described the Doula program that mm-hmm. I wound up volunteering for. It was, in March towards death, like a friend to the end or something like that. I'm butchering the headline a little bit. I'm sorry, Mr. Kleinfeld. I read this article, and it was about just showing up and being enough with your presence to show up. That what are people looking for in their last months of life? Are they looking for more money? Are they looking for
exciting how does palliative care differ from hospice, for example?
It's I would have described it as hospice light, insofar as
so you're working with people that are dying.
Oh yes, yes.
Wow.
So palliative care it comes from the word palliative. I think to palliate is there's a word in Latin that means to mask, and so when you are moving towards palliative care, you're not trying to treat the underlying illness. Actually, that's more in hospice. In palliative care, you can continue to treat the underlying illness. When you have moved on to hospice care, it is solely pain relief. It is no longer you're trying to affect a change in the trajectory of the illness. So in shorthand, hospice is normally for the last 6 months of life, and palliative care might be for the last 18 months of life. And the suite of services that are available to people augments as you move from palliative care to hospice, because you're giving up medical treatments, and then
walking along the street and you see this ad.
I was reading the newspaper and I was like, this is what I want to do. This is my calling. I want to work with people in the last months of their lives. Yes.
And day one of that job, what's that like?
Well, you get trained. I think I had
Clearly,
to do something like
right.
40 hours of training, where you learn about your own emotional responses and how you think of death, and you read some spiritual stuff and learn about the spiritual traditions of a broad variety of people, and then just some basic active listening techniques. I may be forgetting, some rules and regs about.
So I'm curious, in that experience that you had, which is amazing, is there one anecdote or someone who really sticks out to you that you had a fond interaction with
I really enjoyed being with just about everyone in some respects. You get very close. You form very close relationships very quickly because people don't have the luxury of time of kind of dicking around and being standoffish.
Yeah.
So if someone doesn't want to talk to you, they're just going to turn to the wall and you're not going to have a relationship. They're literally going to block you out. You know, I can't hear the song Danny Boy anymore without
God.
Crying because not that it was not always an emotional song, but there was a man, one of my first palliative care patients who I visited in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn, mm-hmm. and worked with for several months. He was a 51-year-old retired postal carrier, just a fun guy, and he used to just call me Danny Boy, and we had some really good times together, and
you would just go over and hang out with him, basically.
Yeah, just go and hang out. He'd make, you know, he'd ask me if I wanted some sandwiches made out of these cold cuts, and then we would just kind of munch on sandwiches and walk around the block a little bit. And you don't have to. The gift is the presence. I wasn't supposed to know how to do anything. I'm not an oncologist. I wasn't a social worker.
It's pretty amazing.
I was working on the trading desk at the time.
Yeah, but as a human, and we forget this, you're hardwired to know how to do a lot of this stuff.
Yes.
You're hardwired to know how to be kind to people.
Right.
Yeah, and just showing up sometimes is enough.
Right.
Just to be in acknowledgement of someone else's presence.
Holding someone's hand.
Sure.
Putting your hand on their shoulder, putting your hand on their head.
Yeah.
You know, just slowing things down, just listening. I mean,
Did most of these people have family? Were they alone? I mean, did they live?
It was a mixed bag. I mean, originally when I started with the doulas, it was a home-based system. Then it changed to a hospital-based system. So I was doing a lot of work in St. Vincent's before it converted and mm-hmm. became residential, and then Bellevue. Talk about like an existential situation. You know, Bellevue has a jail in it.
Because, I did not know that.
Well, so Rikers Island does not have, say, like an oncology unit.
Okay.
They've got like an infirmary, and they could probably, you know, take care of some broken bones, infections, illnesses. But if someone's going to be treated for a life-limiting illness, they're going to be brought to Manhattan and they're going to be brought to Bellevue. And I believe, if memory serves, it was the 12th floor. So you take the elevator up and you get out, and, you know, all of the insignia was different. It was no longer Bellevue. It was, you know, the correctional department plus Bellevue. And you had to go through, you had to enter bars and leave all your, you know, inside the prison and put your phone and everything in a locked case and show that you didn't have anything. And then you would, you know, go visit the individual who was the patient, who also happened to be a prisoner. And I remember in one particular case, I was visiting with an individual who we thought we were going to be able to get a compassionate release for, but the judge struck it down. There was not going to be a compassionate release. The individual who had committed murder was going to die in prison, even though he represented no threat to anyone. He had cancer, had very advanced cancer. He could hardly move. And that was very hard work to stay present and try to stay hopeful and optimistic and have some sense of equanimous demeanor. Well, I'm with a guy who you literally realize, like, he will literally never see the sun again.
Wow.
He will literally never see anything except this shitty lattice work, you know, painted wires through the window and bars on the outside of the window. And so experiences like that, I think, helped give me a different sense of perspective than the
that
sense
really
of perspective.
That really gives you some perspective,
yeah.
For sure.
When
yeah.
you think it's bad because your flight's delayed for a few hours, and then you say to yourself, well, at least I get to see the sun again.
Yeah, it's amazing that I know that, at least in some of the work that I've been doing with myself, it's the more patient I can be with myself, more patient I can be with everybody else.
More patient and more compassionate with yourself.
Yes, yes, yeah. Which is part of the practice. Do mm-hmm. you have a practice? Do you have a daily practice?
I do, and it's been pretty set since last August, which is I get up and I read the Daily Stoics, you know, Ryan Holiday's.
Fantastic.
You know, yeah, so I read what the entry is for the day, and then I journal for maybe 2 or 3 minutes on what I think about that particular entry. And then I do just a 10-minute meditation from Sam Harris's Waking Up app.
Mm-hmm.
And frequently then later in the day, what I will do is listen to some of the other lectures on Sam Harris's app. And I've been a big fan of Professor William Irvine's work, who is a retired philosophy professor from Wright State University, who has, there's like a 5-hour lecture series on Stoicism. And I've really been enjoying that. And I've been, you know, talking it up with my clients as well.
So as you're working with these palliative patients, do you find, do you notice anything going on in yourself where you're noticing things, how you're reacting differently to situations or just thinking about your own place in the universe differently?
Well, I don't know that it's specifically when I'm, and I should point out, when was the last time? I don't think I've done any palliative care volunteerism in probably the last 4 years. Probably the last 5 years. Mm-hmm. So it's been a while. But it was...
You went from a trading desk to working with people that are dying.
In the same day. Volunteerism. So I would leave my office.
Talk
and
about
I would
just like juxtaposition of life.
Yeah. I would go, you know, yelling, screaming, everything's numbers on a screen, to sitting with a 93-year-old bedbound woman, you know, and basically one of the things you do most frequently when you're doing palliative care is something called life review, which is where you just try to get the individual, it's not like we're manipulating getting them, but I shouldn't use that word, but encourage the individual to try to look at their life as if it's one narrative. You know, what's the story of your life? Just like you started with me, you know?
Right.
And so I think when people towards the end of their lives can, you know, at least trace a rough outline that makes some sense to them, that is more comforting to them. And it makes them feel that they have, you know, that their story has made sense in some respect, and that, you know, all stories end.
Yeah, I think a lot of us are trying to make sense of our story on a day-to-day basis.
You got to check out Marshall, my roommate and best friend from college. He sent me about 6 months ago a wonderful song called I Have Loved the Story of My Life by Xander Schloss, who, if memory serves, was, I can't remember if he was in the Circle Jerks or Suicidal Tendencies.
Nice.
Yeah. So
one of those guys.
We make transitions throughout our lives. You know, it's like you go from Repo Man to playing with Joe Strummer to, you know, playing nice acoustic guitar lines.
From the trading desk to the palliative care.
It just, if it was all linear, it would be boring.
Yeah, this is very true. It's like just,
there's nothing about my life that bores me.
Peeling back another layer, seeing what's there.
Whoa, look at that. No, I mean, I could not have scripted this out, you know, if you were to say like, hey, this thing that is making you feel ashamed of yourself or inadequate or non-masculine, you're a kid. Oh, guess what? You're going to be the head of you don't even know that this thing has a name, but at some point you're going to be the president of an organization. You spend all your time hiding this from other people.
Can you think of anything like in your childhood that happened to you that is sort of, was a traumatic event that your body remembers? So I remember like when I first started trying to figure out what the fuck is going on with varying degrees of success, more less than not. I think it was either you told me to read The Body Keeps Score or somebody told me to read The Body Keeps Score.
Bessel van der Kolk.
Basically, like we're walking around in this meat suit.
Right.
That has a memory towards it.
Yes.
Not in your brain, but like your epidermis.
Right.
It remembers everything. And it's the same suit you've been wearing since you came out of your mom's vagina or stomach, if you had a cesarean. And it remembers everything.
Yes.
Can you recall something that happened? Or is it still stored in a part of your brain that consciousness doesn't have access to? And it's manifesting itself in, I'm just not comfortable peeing in public.
So coincidentally, I just read something, and I think it was this morning, so I'm just going to bring it up. I think it was in the New York Times. I was reading an article about insomnia, or, you know, and how it's related to anxiety in some respects. Now, I have insomnia also. I mean, oh boy, anything.
Really?
Oh yeah. And I have been endowed with an extremely active mind. Now, that is not always a good thing. Okay. There are, I'm good at problem solving. I am good, you know, I'm a fast thinker. It's just like, I haven't quite figured out where the off switch is. If you see it, could you just flip it for me? It would be lovely if I could turn it off occasionally. But as I was reading this article about insomnia, you know, one of the professors who was quoted, I think his last name was Palio, said something along the lines of, as organisms, we are seldom more vulnerable as when we're sleeping. And it's just like the kind of penny drop for me. And I was thinking, same thing with paruresis. When you're standing there, or if you're talking about parkapresis, if you're hunched over and you're, you know, defecating, you're pretty easy to pick off.
You're exposed.
You're exposed. If you're just lying there unconscious, you're exposed. And so I think that there are... there's an expression in the anxiety field, which is that nature favors the anxious gene. As much as it doesn't feel good to have anxiety in the body, like being acutely aware of what's going on around you tends to bode well towards your survival.
Oh, my God. Like, just a perfect example. I was in the airport with my wife and my son 2 days ago, and I knew that if I was standing closer to where they start boarding and not behind the throngs of people, I would be able to just, you know, not jump the line or anything, but just be able to like have a smoother transition to get on the aircraft.
Right.
And that was giving me anxiety.
So it was because you were wondering whether someone was going to challenge you to do it. I actually find that situation to be challenging too, but it's the way I conceptualize it is it's because of the uncertainty. It's like,
yes,
is it going to be 20 guys coming from the right? Or are there going to be people from the left? Oh, no. Are there 40, you know, Orthodox people who are going to push strollers on in front of me and take all of the overhead compartments? I mean, you know, or all the military guys going to come out? Who knows? You know, it's stressful and it's irritating.
It's like a control thing where you just don't want to be, you have a hard time letting go because we're so programmed to hold on so tightly to everything because we don't want to relinquish control.
Don't want to relinquish control. Don't want to be weak. Don't want to
be
attacked.
Don't want to be vulnerable. Right?
Don't
or don't want to be exposed.
So this, don't want to be judged
either. This makes sense.
Yes.
So if you have a defense mechanism that's going off with your sympathetic nervous system, you're not going to be exposed. You're not going to put yourself at risk. It's always like, and I know because like you have kids, I have kids. It just, you don't want to put yourself in harm's way. And then when you're looking out for the well-being of others, it's an added layer of anxiety where you want to protect your family.
Right.
It's just like you're innately like, how do I put my, you know, what's the safest situation possible for the people, for the loved ones in my life, whether it's friends, family, whatever, you know, employees.
Mm-hmm.
You just want to just make sure that you're always thinking about what is the risk in whatever you're doing. And after a while, it just becomes fucking exhausting because a lot of the situations you're always trying to think like, where am I exposed? And from working in finance, you're always, where are we exposed? You know, what name are we not up to speed on?
Right.
Like, you know, which, like, where's the slippage?
Right.
And that sort of flows through to life also. So like, it kind of makes sense that if there is some sort of defense mechanism that we're naturally wired with, no one's getting chased by an animal anymore.
That's correct.
That's not happening. But you might be put in a situation where the plane fills up and there's no room for your overhead luggage and you have to check your bag and you spend another hour at Newark Airport waiting for it to come out.
Right. That's exactly what
and
we're trying
like,
to avoid.
Fuck, an hour.
Right. But the key thing
God
is,
damn it.
So what you're pointing out here is something that I point out to all my clients, which is that there is a qualitative difference between discomfort and danger. Okay, so spending an extra hour at Newark when you have just come in from wherever you are and you're already tired, that's uncomfortable, but it is not dangerous to you. If you are taking a leak and you take a look to the left and there's a grizzly bear, you have my full permission to run. That is dangerous to you. And so, you know, it's just we have to figure out is what I am concerned about here discomfort or is it danger? And if it's discomfort, then what I encourage my clients to do is just try to wait it out. You know, just you know, there's a pretty standard response that we call it like the anxiety whoosh. It's like, oh, it just comes upon you. And, you know, you go from 0 to 10 on the Likert scale and you're not anxious and then you are. But if you wait in that situation, most of my clients, then they hit the eject button. So they never learn that if they were to just stay in the situation for 5 or 10 more minutes, it would go from a 10 on the Likert scale, maybe down to a 9.
This is something that I've been discussing at length with very close friends of mine, is getting comfortable being uncomfortable.
Yes.
And if you can master that, nothing is a challenge.
Right.
No matter how uncomfortable you are, it's okay.
Yeah.
You have to let go of that. You know, yes. I have another friend who's just, he's a fitness junkie, and he just says, you got to embrace the suck. Yeah. You know, embrace the suck. Get comfortable being uncomfortable.
Exactly.
You know, let go. It's all saying the same thing.
What therapists would call it is the willful tolerance of uncertainty.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's just saying, instead of saying, I can only use this bathroom if it's this way, and that way, just say like, whatever this bathroom is, I will figure it out. You know, there are better and worse bathrooms, but I will simply figure it out.
So how did you make the shift from working in palliative care?
Yes.
To paruresis?
So...
What happened? Like, was there just like an aha moment where you're like, all right, we're going with the paruresis route, you know? I feel like I'm fulfilled with the palliative care volunteer work.
So oddly enough, it was the process of negative selection, which was I went to NYU's social work school with the idea of being a palliative care worker on the way out. I specifically asked for a palliative care first year internship, and they gave it to me. I did very well, got rave reviews, and then I applied for a second year. It's a 2-year program, for a second year fellowship in palliative care. Wasn't even all that competitive. There were 6 slots and 11 applicants. They rejected me. And so I had to scramble and find a new second year internship. And after many wrong fits and starts, I wound up getting sent to a psychoanalytic institute where I just learned how to do psychoanalysis, and I stayed there for several years. And then during the course of my education there, I had gone to a workshop myself as a symptomatic client back in 2001 when I was 32, right after the towers came down. The International Paruresis Association was a tiny little startup organization back then. It had started in 1996. It was their 5th year or 6th year, and they had a workshop in Newark, New Jersey, and the thought entered my mind, you know, I had found it on the internet, and I thought, after watching a dozen friends just get blown up, like, I'm just not going to die with this stupid fucking condition. I need to do something about this. And so that was my first step away from avoidance and towards health. And I went to this workshop, and I learned the kind of very basic skills of graduated exposure to a desensitization hierarchy, and you know, then would practice in public restrooms. The more I practiced, the better I got. And when I would stop practicing, I would regress. It's a chronic relapsing condition.
That's funny. So
it's like fitness.
For the listeners out there, occasionally I get a video from Dan from an airplane bathroom. Where it's just him encouraging his clients that it was okay, like he actually peed at 30,000 feet and it's all good.
Yeah,
I mean, it's not a graphic video.
No.
It's just
all above the belt.
Yeah, a video in the mirror, like this happened, I did it, and you know, it was not comfortable, but it worked, and you can too. It's like a video of encouragement.
Exactly. I'm always I lead from the front.
I can just kind of imagine you like at at like the garden at a Ranger game, like with your cell phone out, like taking a video of like all the people.
Well, the
at the urinals.
You get a big kick out of this. Yeah. So one of the things.
What are you doing?
One of the things that I do. Yeah. You know, so since most of my clients and myself, when I was most symptomatic, are really afraid that people are judging you or paying attention to you in the bathroom, and really no one is at all. So one of the exercises I'll do when I lead a workshop, and I've got to give credit to Carl Robbins, the co-founder of the IPA, who taught me this fantastic technique. He calls it a shame attacking exercise. And what it is you enact the exact thing you're afraid of. You're afraid that people are going to judge you for looking, you know, for being visibly distressed around your urinating. So I tell the guys at the workshop, I say, okay, I'm going to go to the center urinal here. And I'm going to post up. I'm going to set the timer on my iPhone for 20 minutes. And I'm going to stand there for 20 minutes. And the last time I did this for extra comic effect, I I had been at the buffet and I had taken those cheesy looking gloves that they make you use to handle the bagels. So I put these gloves on. I bought a 32 ounce Diet Coke and I pulled the straw to the meniscus so it just made horrible bubbling noises when I sucked on it. And then I just camped out at the urinal and I kept one of my hands up on the wall, and I would just moan. For 20 minutes. Also, I hiked.
In a public bathroom.
Yeah.
It's people coming.
With their kids, with their fathers. It was in a food court in a mall in Baltimore. Yeah. And I had my jeans hiked down. I ride commando, so you have like 3 inches of crack you can take a look at. And I go for 20 minutes. And what I invite the guys at the workshop. I want you to circulate throughout the restroom, and I want you to closely monitor what people's interactions are with me. There's nothing to report. No one's interacting with me. They're just like, okay.
No one cares.
I mean, they might notice me. I'm not saying that I'm acting strangely. I know I'm acting strangely. But the question is, you know, that I put to these to my clients is, okay, so fine. Even if you act strangely, then what? And the answer is crickets.
It's really amazing that there's no rules to how there's no fucking rules. I don't care. Like, listen, there's morality. And there's virtue.
Right.
But there are no rules.
No.
How you get from fucking point A to point B in any aspect of your life, someone that's telling you you have to do it this way is full of shit. It does not fucking work that way. If you have your moral compass pointed in the right direction and you're sticking to your virtues, whatever they are,
right,
you're good.
Right.
Morality and virtue. No rules. You need to like growl like an old man with one hand on the wall drinking a Coke, you know, in front of the urinal to get you to a point of comfort with yourself, God bless.
Right.
Fucking do it, man.
You know, I mean, one of the things that Adam talks about, you know, we had been mentioning Adam Gopnik's book earlier. I have
tell us a little bit about that.
Oh, okay. So
for those of you who don't know, who is Adam Gopnik?
So Adam Gopnik is a staff writer for The New Yorker, one of the more senior writers of The New Yorker since the 1980s, and he is a beloved and well-known New York City author. He wrote Paris to the Moon, and this is probably his 10th or 11th book at this point. And you know, just a well-known, he's got his own BBC radio show. He's, you know, he's just a well-known guy. And he came in, and a phenomenal writer, and a lovely guy. And just so people understand, I am a boundaried therapist. I never talk about my clients at all by name. Mm-hmm. However, this particular client, he and I have discussed this in great detail, and he decided to include a chapter in a recent book that just came out on the 14th. The book is called The Real Work on the Mystery of Mastery, and there is a chapter, punnily enough, called Relieving, and it is an extensive chapter and a serious chapter about the work that we've been doing together for the last 4 years as a man in his 60s, decided to try to unwind the serious kind of consequences and the phobia that had accrued of having paruresis for the last 50 years.
Wow.
And so there's 50 years of difficult habits to kind of unwind. But what he, you know, Adam specifically talks about in the chapter, that one of the things that I taught him was that anything goes in a public restroom in New York City. We think that, you know, if you spend 18 seconds there instead of 14 seconds there, something's wrong and the mall cop's going to pull you out of there. And realistically, one of the reasons I take all these videos is because, you know, there's guys showering in the sink. There's guys cutting their toenails. I was once in a men's room in, Palisades Interstate Park. Someone was cooking with a hibachi.
In a bathroom.
You know, I mean, and... I spend 6 to 10 hours a week in public restrooms, so I see the full spectrum of human behavior that's going on in there. And you will never be noticed. You would have to basically be lighting things on fire to get negative attention drawn to yourself in a public restroom. I mean, I've been in, you know, in the bathrooms in Washington Square Park where people are literally shooting up in the urinal next to me. I don't judge. And that guy wasn't judging. That guy was hardly sentient, but.
And was not really concerned with whether or not you had to pee.
Right. No, he just, whether it took me 15 seconds or a minute and 15 seconds to start my stream, he did not notice.
And we will be right back. And now, back to our show.
So with the patients, when you start working with someone, is it, and I understand that there's steps that you take and there's exercises that you can do to get you more comfortable being uncomfortable. And then over time, hopefully there's progress. And then, you know, at the extreme, you're not homebound anymore. Cause I'm sure there are some people that just, they don't want to leave home or they're just severely dehydrated all the time, which is really unhealthy.
Yes.
Do you get, like, as a therapist, like, what do you get in? Do they have therapists as well as you helping them with their paruresis, or are you acting as their therapist because of the paruresis?
So it's a mixed modality. There are some people where I am soup to nuts. I'm helping them out, you know, where I'm working with them around paruresis. Then they start floating some trial balloons about things that are going on with their wife. And I'm like, well, you know, I'm also a couples counselor. I can kind of give you some advice on that. And, you know, maybe it goes on to some career advice. There are people who have started with me and will see me for several years. But more often than not, I kind of market myself like a sandwich. Mm-hmm. It's just like, I'm not interested. If you have a therapist, I am not interested in taking a case away from that therapist. If you're happy with that therapist, continue to see that therapist. But if that therapist hasn't been particularly helpful at resolving an important issue for you, you know, I'm the guy who will get you out of the sand. And then that's it. You don't tee off with your sand wedge. You don't do anything but hit it out of the rough. Mm-hmm. Or wait, no, I'm mixing my metaphor. You hit it out of the trap. It's just, you can use me for 8 to 12 sessions to just try to, you know, learn the basics. Or we can have I have taken on new open-ended clients as recently as last week. Just people, you know, I don't book myself or I don't vaunt myself solely as being a paruresis therapist. It just happens to be the thing that I'm best known for.
Wow.
You know, I mean,
who would have thunk? Danny Rocca from the neighborhood.
Milburn class of 87. If anyone did not know that I had a shy bladder, you now do. Any comments, letters, postcards, send them to danrocker.com, or you can send it to me at 160 West End Avenue, Suite 1N. I'll be happy to entertain all comers.
It's really amazing, like, how something in life goes awry somewhere.
Yeah.
And manifests itself in the inability to relieve oneself, which is something that should be the most innate and easiest thing to do.
Think about insomnia again. You know, I mean, 30, you know, a solid third of the country is really not getting good sleep. What could be more important or easier than falling asleep?
Yeah.
I mean, that's another way of relieving yourself that, and Adam mentions that in his chapter as well about, you know, at least with insomnia.
Do you find any common thread with the patients?
Yes.
Okay, so what's that thread?
So, let's see how to best phrase this. So I create a metaphor for my clients and I say, okay, you come in and you're pointing at one star in the heavens, right? You're saying, you see that star? And that's paruresis. Mm-hmm. I don't like that. Get rid of that. And I'll say, okay, all right, I got it. I got my marching orders. But before we get started, let's just step back and look around the star to see if that star is attached to anything else that we don't want to get rid of. And as it turns out, that star, yeah, I'm thinking of the North Star. What is that, a part of the Big Dipper or something? I don't remember. Something, I'm not good with astronomy, so maybe I should learn a little more if I'm going to use this metaphor. But it's attached to a character cluster. So my clients, I have never been stiffed by a paruresis client, okay? Mm-hmm. They are always punctual, if not early. The careers that they tend to come from are, at first it seems surprising, traders, lawyers, people in the arts, people who are like copyright editors, accountants, IT people, police, and fire, a lot of fire. And so what do all these things have in common? Really important granular distinctions. Is that comma in the right place? If it's not, the whole contract's fucked up. Mm-hmm. Is that out? Is that fire out? Is it still smoldering? You know, being really careful and detail-oriented and hyper-vigilant are things that tend to get us rewarded in all these other aspects of our lives, but they bite you in the balls in the bathroom.
Interesting.
You don't want to spend a whole lot of time being hyper-vigilant and paying attention to everything that's going on around you in the
bathroom.
Male
and female, or is this more?
Female as well. Female as well. Does not, females tend to present less for treatment. I think, you know, I've probably seen literally a 10 to 1 ratio of guys to women.
Well, it makes sense because, you know, women are not, you know, peeing in bathrooms that are public and open. I mean, there's a stall with a door you can close most of the time.
So that's the case. But remember that one of the big triggers is auditory. And it's not, is someone hearing me urinate? It's more like, oh, no, people are experiencing the accumulating silence. And they can tell I'm not urinating, and they're wondering if something's wrong with me.
Got it.
And so one of the ways in which it can be more difficult, and women can avoid yet more than men, which is surprising and counterintuitive, is that I would never ask you, hey, Greg, I got to take a piss. You want to come with me to the bathroom? Well, no. I mean, the guys don't tend to do that,
no.
Right? Women do.
Unless they're doing drugs.
No, right, exactly. it would be like, hey, can I follow you to the bathroom? Yeah. No, but the, you know, for, you know, I've worked with female clients, you know, here's an example, an individual, you know, takes a job, new job, she's the new person. And so someone else says to her, hey, you know, the gals and all, we all go to get nachos and margaritas on Thursday night. Want to come with? And this, you know, the woman is concerned she won't be able to urinate in the bar. So she makes an excuse. Then the next week she makes a different excuse. After the fourth week, they stop asking her and she kind of gets a reputation as being a stick in the mud. She's not a stick in the mud. She wants to go out with her colleagues, but she knows that if she does, and one of the, you know, and she has to go to the ladies' room, there's a really high chance, you know, significant chance that one of them is just gonna say, "Oh, I'll come with. You know, we can. I'll hold your bag. Mm-hmm. We'll powder each other's nose." I don't know. I don't have the language completely down because
I'm with you. I'm
following. You know what I'm saying?
You.
But like, guys don't do that. So you know, women. Women tend to develop less of what we call the secondary paruresis. And just to give you a quick you know, primer on, you know, primary, secondary, the symptom itself is primary. Go to the bathroom, you're standing there with your junk hanging out, hoping that you're going to urinate. It's not happening. After 2 minutes, you wash off and leave. That is primary paruresis. It's what a fly on the wall would see, what a video camera would capture while we're having our paruretic moments. Secondary paruresis is the negative thoughts, feelings, self-evaluation, and shame that tend to accrue to having primary paruresis. So if you then think like, I am a complete loser, I have a funny video with Peter Griffin from The Family Guy where he was having a lockup with Quagmire at Fenway, and he says, come on, you're hearing his internal monologue. Come on, Peter, your dad fought in World War II and you can't even pee in a urinal? What the hell is wrong with you? That is secondary paruresis. And so women tend to have less than that, less of that, rather. Men tend to think that this is a direct hit to our manhood, to our masculinity, because of the dual function of the penis. We use it for something else, if we're lucky. And it's just, you know, I remember...
Is there like any sort of common thread of stuff that happened to these people as children? Or,
no.
You know,
it's like, that. It's, you know, it's like asking the same question about insomnia. It's like, well, why do I have insomnia and why does someone else? I mean, I guess you could say that you know, one of the things that Dan has in common with Adam, his client, is that they're both, you know, cerebral, high-strung people.
So racing mind,
yes,
usually goes hand in hand with paruresis.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Racing mind, or as Marty Seif and Sally Winston, who are very well-known anxiety therapists, they refer to it as a sticky mind.
Yeah.
You know, something gets stuck there, and then we just kind of ruminate.
All right, so... I recently discovered a guy named Dr. Russell Kennedy. Are you familiar with any of his work?
Oh, no, you sent me the image of
he's suffered from anxiety for years.
Uh-huh.
And all of the therapies that he tried to work with never healed his anxiety because it was all mind-based.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the medical term for it is, but he came up with a theory that having some sort of somatic experience, like finding where it is in your physical body that the anxiety is manifesting itself. For a lot of people, like I know if I'm feeling anxious, it's in my stomach, mm-hmm. like the pit of my stomach. Some people it's in their sternum, it's in their chest.
Yep.
Some people get it in their traps and their shoulders.
I apparently get it in my pelvic floor.
You get it in your pelvic floor.
Yeah.
So when the anxiety builds up, it's...
Yeah, it's basically... the irony is... and it's really not all that helpful, is that when you get anxious, one of the frequent physical concomitants of the anxiety is a desire to urinate. Like you just, animals, when a zebra realizes that it's been scented and a tiger or a cheetah, whatever typically eats zebras, is going to chase it down, as it starts to run, it will empty its bowels as it's running. And it's because literally it's trying to make weight. It's trying to, like, everything that is excessive, you know, all the blood is being pulled away from the vital organs and sent to the arms, not on a zebra, to whatever you call it on a zebra, legs, you know, and it start, you know, and you start running because the idea is get away from, you know, that which is pursuing.
And we will be right back. And now back to our show.
Is there a thought where instead of working on, you know, going here into the head, I have my hand on my temple right now, like going into the body and trying to find in the body where the trigger point is, like what's happening to get into something that happened in the past. Whereas, you know, Dr. Vandercook would tell you again, the body's keeping score the whole time, but it's keeping score in a place that consciousness doesn't have access to. There is something that happened somewhere along the line that is manifesting itself in this bizarre behavior. And it could be insomnia also, or it could be whatever. Like, it's just when you're, I mean, do any of these other people have like physical health issues at all? Or is it basically just completely psychosomatic?
It's almost,
exclusively psychosomatic.
If there was a physical component, I would refer out for until it was treated. And then we would reassess and say, like, okay, now that you've taken a course of Flomax or your Roxetrol, you've had a TURP, you've had some kind of surgery, like, does it work better now? And if the answer is no, then okay, now we'll resume our work. And if the answer is yes, then it's like, okay, gay gesund. It was a physiological problem. You know, you don't have to talk to me. I'm not trying to say, okay, like, where is it in your body, and then trying to draw a connection from that person's personal history to that part of their body, as much as it's okay, let's actually focus on what you're feeling in your body right now. You're standing at a urinal. Your fingers are feeling a little cold. Your blood.
So you do actually go into the body and try to like recreate. Instead of
we're literally in the bathroom. We're talking about it as
right.
it's happening,
and trying to not be in your head thinking about, oh my God, is somebody looking at me? Versus, you know, what is it? What does it smell like in here? What is my body feeling?
Sure,
right now?
I mean there's like, that famous, you know, what are five things I can see? What are four things I can hear? What are three things? You don't want to taste much in the bathroom. I don't really know. But it's there are these little So what you're talking about is, I talk about this a lot in therapy, the distinction between what if, which is anxious thinking. That's like worrying. What if Greg asked me a bunch of questions I don't know how to answer?
Spiraling out. Right, exactly. And it's just a never-ending cycle of, you know, fuck.
And then there's what is. And what is what's actually happening in the moment. There is actually a microphone here. I am actually facing you. We are actually in New York City. These are things that are, okay? Mm-hmm. And when we can move our clients from what if to what is, it's really good for them, because what if is only limited by your creativity. And as Dave Carbonell, who's a very well-known Chicago anxiety therapist, says, what if is anticipatory anxiety, or what if thinking is basically saying, let's pretend something bad.
Yeah, exactly. No, like, that's exactly
what
it is.
This is what's not happening. Let's think about what's bad.
That's like the root of anxiety there.
Exactly. Yeah. And so like, let's get the hell away from what if, and just, you know, I'm focusing, I'm looking at you. You're right here. I'm right here. This is what is. I'm not thinking about, you know, what if your next question is wildly inappropriate. And
why I'm so
it.
Fascinated with this. It just, I mean, it's because I get, you know, I've been dealing with anxiety, which I, you know, for most of my life, and have just at, you know, I'm 50 now, coming to terms with, yeah, I'm anxious. I'm an anxious person. My parents were anxious people. Mm-hmm. Their parents were anxious people. Mm-hmm. My great grandparents were anxious people, and dealing with all kinds of adversity and how they got here from Eastern Europe and things that happened to my parents, and, you know, whether that anxiety is inherited. And when you see it manifesting in something as challenging as paruresis, it kind of really makes me want to think about, like, how do you unpack, like, where is this coming from? Why is the body manifesting this in itself? And I understand, it's anxiety based. So this makes sense to me. And just getting into what is versus what if brings you back into the present.
Yes.
Which grounds you and brings you back into your body. So, I mean, I said, I have all these practices that I've been picking up off of like different podcasts and people that I hear, like Mel Robbins. She has the high five habit.
Okay.
You high five yourself in the mirror and just say, okay, I got you. You know, and basically you're acknowledging yourself on a daily basis, and it starts to build this whole pattern up of just neuroplasticity where you're just saying, like, no matter how crazy you look in the morning or what's going on, you feel okay about yourself. Mm-hmm. It's just, I got it, you know, I'll make it through the day. And then one of the things that Dr. Kennedy was talking about was reminding yourself that you're safe in the present moment.
Mm-hmm.
Like right now, you and I are in the studio, you know, Joe's got his arms crossed and his brow is furrowed, listening intently, but we're safe. We're not being chased by anything. Like, things are okay now. I'm not thinking like,
I trust Joe. He seems like a lovely guy.
I trust Joe too. Yeah, I definitely trust Joe. We're not thinking about like a what if moment,
right,
where life could go spiraling out. Like, am I going to make it home on the subway?
Right.
Will I survive that?
Yes.
You know, I've taken the subway so many times. It's, yeah, I'll probably survive it, you know. There might be a homeless guy who shit himself in the car with me, but whatever. I can deal with that. You know, I'll make it home safe.
That would be discomfort, not danger.
Yeah. but I'm comfortable being uncomfortable with that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I what's so funny, and again,
so do you, working with all these people and doing the work, do you find that you yourself are less anxious now than you were when you started?
Totally.
Because you're surrounded by this all day long.
Yes. Because it normalizes it, and it gives me the privileged perch. It's like being a secular priest. You know, people come and they confess to us, and we get to, you know, in the same way that the priest would know what was going on in the town, I get a better sense of like what's going on with guys with this problem by and large. Or when I'm doing couples therapy, with the various ways in which, you know, couples can have less happy marriages or less happy relationships. And it just, it gives me a tremendous sense of, how to best put this, I feel extremely grateful, and I have there's no rule that says, I know this might sound obnoxious, but there's no rule that says that you know, that I can't learn from my clients and watch them make mistakes and say, oh, that's the way that looks when it's tried out within a couple, I got to make sure that I am not going to do that.
Yeah
So it's like there is I try to model what I think behavior is that will be more helpful, but there's nothing that says that I can't learn from seeing stuff that doesn't work and just be like, okay, glad I didn't have to learn that firsthand.
Where do you think, you know, it's kind of interesting, because if I look at the trajectory of how you wound up in this seat, you know, going from working on trading desks to, you know, palliative care to working with paruresis, like, what's next? Like, where do you see yourself? If you could do anything in, you know, 5-10 years from now, like, what interests you right now?
I think I found my calling. I don't think there is a next. I think we're getting up there. Mm-hmm. I have no plans on retiring. I'm going to be 54 next, or in the beginning of May. I have a supervisor who's 87, and I still talk to him every week. And if I could still be doing this at 87, I will be doing this at 87. There are, I get tremendous satisfaction out of my job now. It ain't Wall Street money, but it's not terrible. And it is, every day I feel like I'm helping people, and they tell me I'm helping them.
It goes back to being of service.
Yeah. That's what the advice I gave my kids. You know, I mean, I don't know what they're going to do in life, but I always just said, serve someone.
Yep.
Like, you know, just like I think Bob Dylan had it in a song, but it's just like, you got to serve someone. I'm not telling you how to serve them, but, you know, don't just go follow your passion, follow your bliss. There's nothing wrong with that. Well, I like Joseph Campbell, so I shouldn't say I'm not going to shit on following your bliss. I feel like I'm following my bliss, but I am at the same time serving people while doing so. You know, it's not like I've just decided,
well, it's
I'm going to
ride
my
Ouroboros. It's
right,
the
yeah,
snake.
Right, right.
It's like feet eating its own tail. It's the cycle. Like,
yeah,
you are doing something that is fulfilling and enjoying to you, and that's being of service.
I mean, and twice this week so far, I've had the opportunity to have an initial session with a college student or a high school student and just be able to look at that kid in the eye through Zoom because they're out of state and just be like, I'm going to give you what I wish to God I had when I was your age, and I had no idea where to find it, mm-hmm. but I'm going to give it to you. And as long as you just follow these instructions, like, you will not have this problem anymore. Like, it's going to take work, but this is a solvable problem. And, you know, they light up. They are.
How could they not light up? I mean, it's got to be, you feel so alienated and terrified.
Yep.
Like, you're at school and you're a teenager, which is hard enough. I mean, I don't even want to think about what it was like.
Yeah.
And then not being able to pee at school because you're terrified.
Yep. Yep. I actually, you know, what's interesting is that paruresis is a condition that is negative. I'm going to use some psychobabble for a second here. It is like negatively operantly reinforced through avoidance, which is a fancy way of saying that, okay, if you're six and you're afraid of the dark and dogs, when you're 26, there's a very low likelihood you're still going to be afraid of the dark and dogs. You'll just outgrow it. You don't have to go to a therapist to not be afraid of the dark anymore. Most kids outgrow that. But if you have paruresis when you're 16, chances, and you don't do anything about it, chances are it's going to be much, much worse when you're 26. Now, why is that? It's because there's no such thing as anti-behavior. Behavior is all affirmative. It's all positive. It all, you know, even something that is a negative behavior, it's just something that has happened, okay? So when you leave a bathroom having not urinated, you are not anti-urinating. You are executing and reinforcing avoidance.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's like you're building the avoidance bicep. It's getting stronger and stronger. It's doing dips. Every time you give up, you're increasing the likelihood and the speed with which you're going to go to avoidance as a defense mechanism next time. And so you just get better and better at avoiding, which is getting worse and worse at living.
Yeah. I guess I'm curious, do a lot of your patients, obviously working with you, they would say that they have an uptick in quality of life because they get better than that. But outside of the bathroom, in terms of how they go about their day to day, are there other parallels with working with you that sort of manifest themselves in, you know, a more beneficial life?
Yes, absolutely. And that's happened with me. I say working on any anxiety works on all the anxieties. So the metaphor I've come up with, and I don't know if it's my own metaphor, if I catched it from somewhere, so I apologize to someone who's smarter than me if they came up with this metaphor. It's like, think of it as a hydrocarbon field. Like, you know, it's the oil reserves that are underground. Okay. Mm-hmm. You put a derrick down here and you start pumping, oil comes out. That's, say, paruresis. You put a derrick here and start pumping, that's insomnia. But it's still the same oil that's coming up. It's the same substance. It's like there's one anxiety in the body. It just kind of travels to different parts of the body and manifests itself in different ways. So let me give you an example. I went to the shops at Hudson Yards in early 2021. It was still deep COVID. I went in there. Mm-hmm. I was just really interested in scoping out the men's rooms and seeing if it was good for doing practice with my guys. So I'm in the shops at Hudson Yards.
I love how you just troll around the city, like looking for spots.
Oh, totally.
If you could practice with them. So like you bring your clients into these public places.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So you're always scouting men's rooms.
I mean, Adam joked about it in the about it in the chapter. He said I sounded like a real estate dealer. I'm like, it's a classic 6-6. Look at this. It's a 1-1 on the top of the hill with the brick finishes. It's lovely. You know, it's for you. I can see you in here. So
Urinal has ice in it. You're going to love it.
You're going to love it. Exactly.
This is the one in McSorley's. It's 3.5, 4 feet tall.
Oh,
you could stand in it if you
wanted
to.
Right. I was going
to
say those are like phone booths. But the so I'm in the shop at Hudson Yards and I'm pissing up a storm and I'm having a great time. And I think, I think, oh, wow. I really hope this place doesn't go out of business. Because I mean, this was deep COVID. This was February 21.
Yeah.
And there was no one in there. So believe it or not, I'm thinking like, I want to throw the mall operators some extra money to make sure they stay in business. So they have this thing called the edge where you can take an elevator up 1150 feet, walk out on this, you know, triangular shaped, you know, deck. And it's the gimmick is that there are no bars, you know, the wind, it's very thick glass. So it just looks like you can see to the horizons,
right.
You know, it looks like you can walk right off. And then there is a triangular portion in the center that's cut out. And you can walk over and look straight down 1,150 feet on the taxis below you, right? And so the funny thing is,
I don't think of myself as someone who's afraid of heights. I've been skydiving. I used to go cliff jumping, but I haven't done it in a long time and I wasn't expecting it. And when I walked across the thing, I got the anxious whoosh. It just popped up in me like my heart started racing. So I stepped back off it and I immediately said to myself, okay, I'm just going to create a desensitization hierarchy for this. I teach all my clients to do desensitization hierarchies for urinals. I'm going to create a desensitization hierarchy for this. Let's see, what am I sure I can do now? Well, I am absolutely certain I can walk around the perimeter of it with no fear. Okay, so I do that. Then I notice, I'm like, well, I noticed when I had my cell phone out and I was taking pictures, for some reason, having the view mediated by the cell phone, by the camera, made me less anxious. I was focusing on the camera and less the height. Mm-hmm. So I walked across it, but I used my camera as like a lens that I was looking through. Then I walked across a corner. Then I walked across a longer corner. And then after that, I was ready to walk across the middle again. But those are the kind of skills that you pick up. And you pick, you know, those are cognitive behavioral CBT skills, cognitive behavioral therapy skills, graduate exposure skills, exposure response prevention skills. And they can be adapted to any situation. So if you were to say, I got public speaking anxiety, then I'd say, well, okay, let's see if we can have you arrange for you to talk to, you know, your three nieces and nephews on the topic, you know, mm-hmm. and then maybe you can talk to, you know, a group of friends, and then maybe you can, you know, get up in Washington Square Park and read a poem. I mean, I'm just spitballing here, but you would, and then maybe you would join
Toastmasters. You have to ascend into the thing that it is that makes you anxious. Gradually.
That, you know, you've heard, there's so many quotes that are, you know, that are like this, you know, life begins at the end of your comfort zone is actually, it sounds kind of cheesy. It's true.
It is true.
You just got to go to the end of your comfort zone.
Because I have some travel anxiety, yep. and I have to travel for work and I want to take vacations with my family. And it's like, it can be a Sunday night. My trip is 3 or 4 weeks away and I will get crippling anxiety and I feel it in the pit of my stomach, even though a month from now, and it's just the what if I'm late to the airport?
Like, right.
What if something goes wrong? But then on the day where I have to travel, I'm totally fine.
That is because in the first example, you're talking about what if.
Exactly.
And in the second example, you're talking about what is. And so I'll send you a video that you'll like. Marty Seif and Sally Winston just were interviewed by Drew Linsalata talking about their recent anticipatory anxiety handbook that they had published. Anticipatory anxiety tends to be the last part of anxiety to go. So you can actually get better at traveling, or I could get better at public urinating, but still have that feeling, what if this time? Mm. What if I drop my skills? And the key thing is to, when you have feelings like that, to just say to yourself, you know what? This is my anticipatory anxiety. My anticipatory anxiety has not proven to be a good prognosticator. It is a liar. It is a bluffer. It
oh,
is
an it's such a fucking liar.
It is not accurate. So I'm just going to put this aside for the time
except for
being.
During COVID when we got stranded somewhere, but my anxiety worked out. I scrambled to whatever. That's a different story.
Well, actually, you know, back on 9/11 when stuff went down and I was in Trinity,
yeah.
As Adam writes about it in his book, like, because I told him my story, it's like I actually felt that second plane come up while I was taking a leak at Trinity. I felt it come up through my legs.
Oh, my God.
Like the vibration. We were that close. And I immediately, because I do have an active mind that does tend towards, you know, the negative, you know, being raised by a short seller and having catastrophic thinking, what could go wrong?
Yeah.
And, you know, knowing that there was a Holocaust not that long ago, you know, there are things that can go wrong. And I just walked right in. I said, I'm taking Grace right now. And I took her. I put her in the stroller. I went downstairs. There were people sitting there taking pictures. There were people who just didn't get out of the way. I mean, I'm sure they're fine. They didn't die. But I'm sure they had horrific traumatic experiences getting out of there. After I was just like, nope, got the kid. I'm running home as fast as I can. And it's like they're...
Did you notice an uptick in your paruresis post 9/11 versus pre 9/11?
You know, actually, the red herring or the confound variable there would be I went to treatment immediately thereafter. So if anything, it should have gotten better, not worse. Mm-hmm. But so I don't recall. But here's what I can tell you. Another analogy I use with my clients, a toilet analogy. I'll say, hey, you know, you've taken the top off a toilet and fixed the floater, right? Yeah. Okay. So think of the water level in the tank as your general background anxiety level. Think of the floater as your dominant go-to symptom. So for me, it's going to either be insomnia or paruresis, you know, and as the general background anxiety, oh, maybe I lost money because I made a bad, well, actually I don't trade anymore, but say I redeemed badly and I did, you know, I made a financial misstep or, you know, say,
or you said something you're ashamed of.
I said something I'm ashamed of. Someone in my family isn't well or something like that. You know, the background anxiety is rising. That just means that, you know, it's not that I'm selectively deciding now's a good time to be more pee-shy. It's just like, that's going to come up at that point, you know? And I'll just say to myself, and this is what I tell my clients, I'll say, yeah, remember that Tom Petty song, Walls? Just tell yourself, some days are diamonds, some days are rocks. Today's just a rock, okay? It's just, today's not a diamond day,
yep.
You know? Or, was it Bridge Over Troubled Water? Hello, Darkness, My Old Friend?
Sure.
I'll just, as soon as it shows up and I feel the anxiety, I'll just be like, hello, darkness, my old friend. You don't really have to be here. It's okay. I'll tolerate you.
Yeah, there is this whole element of surrender that goes
exactly.
into it.
You know, just, it's like, I am not going to...
Come get me.
Yeah,
here I am.
From acceptance, from acceptance and commitment therapy, Russ Harris has this fantastic metaphor. He calls it the struggle switch. Imagine that you've got a switch in front of you, and it's just two directions, and it's set to bad. And the other setting is worse. You want to engage with the struggle switch, or do you just say, okay, it's bad, could be worse,
yep.
And I'm just not going to truck with it. You know, I'm just going to leave it there. I don't have to. This is, you know, to talk about the dichotomy of control that the Stoics have. This is not something where I have to jump in and affect a change. This is something I just have to tolerate.
Dan, do you have a website? Like, if people want to,
learn
more about you and.
Yeah, danrocker.com.
Danrocker.com.
Danrocker.com. And I think if you're really only interested in the paruresis side of the practice, you can skip right ahead to itsarestroom.com. I like to tell people, like, hey, it's a restroom. Rest. It's a comfort station for your comfort, a relief station for your relief. Itsarestroom.com. And also the International Paruresis Association. Which is, you know, the organization that I'm the president of, and I really credit it with making a very significant difference in my life. I frankly don't know what I would be doing if I hadn't discovered what this was and that I could do something about it.
Pretty amazing. What was the first live concert you ever went to?
Rush Moving Pictures Tour.
That was first live music experience.
Yeah.
And who was it with?
Ben Rothfeld, who was a classmate of mine. His mother... It was really cool. She unfortunately passed away about 20 years back, but she brought Ben and a bunch of his friends in December of 82 for his bar mitzvah to the Moving Pictures Tour at Brendan Byrne Arena.
That's a pretty great show.
And there was some gal in front of me throwing up, and yeah, I mean, it was like a full on.
I ask everybody what their first concert was for a seventh grader.
It was an eye opener, and oh my God, Tom Sawyer was my favorite song for years.
That was a great song.
That's an awesome song.
I thought for years that my first live show was Kiss on the Animalize tour, probably in like 84 with John Kent, who lived across the street from me. But thinking about it a little more, actually the first live music I ever saw was it was like Dean Martin and Sammy Davis Jr. at Radio City with my grandma Rita.
Wow.
Took me into the city. She's like, we're going to go see some music. And I had no idea what was going on.
Did you think it was cool?
That was super cool. Just being, you know, like 5 or 6 years old in Radio City, seeing Sammy Davis Jr., you know.
Yeah, I mean,
he has a cover of the Wichita Lineman, by the way, which is one of the most fire covers of Glenn Campbell's Wichita Lineman I've ever heard.
I will have to check
it's
that
pretty,
out.
It's pretty good, yeah.
And I do remember seeing Beatlemania when it was in the Winter Garden Theater.
The Winter Garden Theater,
yes,
yeah.
In 1980, I saw Beatlemania. But I digress. Now I'm just wandering all over the field.
And you home base is New York City.
Yes.
But you travel around the country.
I do. I lead workshops. Last year, I led them in Baltimore and Chicago and Los Angeles. And I travel and wherever there are a large group of guys who want to get together and work on this, they can write to the IPA. And, you know, chances are I'll throw down and show up.
There you go. Throw it down and show on up.
I mean, yeah, look, at this point, it's like leading a weekend workshop. It's a really intense thing. It's like 16 hours of programming over a weekend, but like I've got it pretty much wired down where I wouldn't say I could do it in my sleep, but I would say that I've done it a lot.
So for paruresis sufferers out there, or people who know people that, you know, will admit to having paruresis,
yes,
danrocker.com.
Yes, you know, or the International Paruresis Association is a great place, you know, to find. There are a lot of resources.
Or it's a restroom.com.
Or it's a restroom.com. Perfect. Yeah.
Wow, well, Dan, thank you so much for coming down. It was just absolute pleasure. Just times usually just evaporates when you're speaking to people, and paruresis especially.
Particularly when I am speaking with you, my yes. friend.
So remember, people, we're all just driving a meat-covered skeleton on a rock, hurtling around the sun at 67,000 miles an hour. So drink good coffee, listen to good music, and be kind to the humans.
Yes, be kind to everyone, for everyone you meet is fighting a hard battle.
Amen.